anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time. We ask you a 5-minute time limit per person be followed. Please come forward, state your name, address, and topic to be addressed. Is there anyone? Seeing no one, then I would move on to recognition and thank you. Dr. Carlson.
We'd like to thank Ron and Beth Keene for their donation of school supplies. This was specific to Prairie View Elementary, to a Prairie View Elementary student as far as a backpack goes. And so just, again, thank you to Ron and Beth Keene for thinking of the school district in Prairie View Elementary.
Okay, thank you very much. And then moving on to reports and discussion. Independent auditors report. Mr. Clark?
At the annual meeting, the treasurer, Mr. Dunlap, presented a preliminary audit report. The final audit report has been received, and each board member received copy along with the management letter. Audited management letter will also, in fact, has already been posted to the district website, so it's available to the public. The audit report contains no findings. That's a good thing. And the management letter identifies no management suggestions, which is also a good thing. You'll be asked to approve the audit report at, I believe, the September 23rd meeting.
Okay. So are there any questions about the audit or in the audit report or the management letter?
I guess just one quick question and a comment. This was our first year with a new firm, as I understand. Was the process from the district's perspective just as seamless as, I mean, it appears from the report just as good, which is always great confirmation because now a second auditor has given us an excellent unqualified opinion, but from the district's perspective as
they're a quality firm. I would not say it went as smoothly, but I think that's only the first year getting to know who within our office is responsible for what activities, what we call documents. It's just local verbiage, but quality firm did a nice job for us. Took a little bit longer, I think, on their part than they were hoping for, and it's just because of the familiarity. So we're excited and happy with the work.
Yeah, very nice report.
And we have a multi-year contract with them, correct?
Correct. Typically 5 years. As you know, many of the large items that we bid on 5 years. So unless something should come up in the intervening years, this would be the first of 5 years.
And I think that's pretty typical, the first year with a new firm organization taking a little longer. And then after that, they'll look at their notes and be more familiar. So. Great. Well, thank you, Jay, and to your staff for all the work they did with that. The next item is executive assistant base wage agreements, and I don't know if you want to do the administrator supervisor agreements as well. Dr. Carlson.
I'll speak to both of them, and then Mr. Clark, if I miss anything, you can fill in. But this is actually our last employee groups. The issue paper that you have before you for both groups, very similar template then to compared to the others that we have brought forward to you. Just a reminder, though, that unlike the previous six agreements brought to you, these two recommendations, they're not necessarily agreements that are negotiated with our executive assistants or administrators and supervisors, since they are not members of a bargaining group. But I wanted you to know that we met with representatives of both of all the groups, and our large executive secretary group, we met with representatives from that group, all two of them, and had to, again, and I appreciate the time that those individuals gave to that conversation. And we applied the same methodology calculating that was used for the other groups. Quite frankly, again, it's that longevity piece that comes into play. And then for these two groups, that's pretty much it. And then the rest is looked at that base for our administrative supervisors. I refer to it as a salary, a base salary, and for our executive assistants, a base wage. So with our executive assistants, you see, again, we operated within the 2.07% total. And longevity, you'll see, again, doesn't play much of an impact with this very small group. And so you see the recommendation to move forward with this, and similar with the administrative and supervisory group. Again, coming along a time where there was very little movement with longevity, and that's just consistent with the practice of all the other employee groups as well. And so you'll see that that base wage or base salary percent will vary between the different groups. And in these are two groups that it ends up, again, that increase to the base wage or base salary is compared to is higher than some of our other groups. So we've been through this same template with the board recently with the other groups. I would have to say, just to add a comment here, at our opening day with our staff, I had several comments afterwards. It was just nice to be able to say to our employees, with the exception of these two groups, although I did mention that I anticipated that the board would certainly approve these. It was nice to be able to say to our employees that the board supported and supported them in agreeing and approving the ratification of those employee group contracts. So thank you for doing that. With that, Mr. Clark, anything further on that? And be happy to take questions, but this is on the consent as well. Here's a good chance to ask questions, clarification if you have any.
Are there any questions? Well, I just for clarification for the entire board, I know on the administrative supervisory base wage salary, it indicates that the continuous growth stipends and value recognition is not included in the base wage increases. Could you explain what those two items are? And
sure.
Just briefly.
The value recognition, is really that longevity piece. So that's, as we have said with the other groups, that's really, when you say it's not part of that 2.07, it's within still what we calculate in. But with this group, the longevity, I'm not sure. Mr. Clark, do you recall, did we have, as far as movement on the
There was one person that achieved the 10 years, it is a threshold, 10 years of service to the district. And
the continuous growth stipend?
And the continuous growth is something that I approve. For example, we had one person, and I'm going to recognize that person because of the work that she has done. Wendy Savasky completed our Wisconsin Forward examiner training. And actually is in the middle of completing her second examination of an organization. So didn't have to do that, but there she is doing it again. And so that is the one, and we recognize that there's a stipend, an annual stipend that's awarded. Similar, we have something, for example, if an individual earns a degree beyond what they must have. So for example, the doctorate degree, we have a current member of our team that is receiving that because she has received that since she has been employed with us. So there are certain things that they can, through their continuous growth, achieve as far as certification.
And that is the reason. And that was the one I was trying to get at, is that's very similar than what we did with the HEA in recognizing their continuing credits, lane movement, although in the administrative supervisory contracts, it's done, it only is when they hit a certain threshold. So if they have a bachelor's, they reach a master's, then they would receive that, and if they went on to a doctorate, they would receive that. I thought it was important that we were consistent with not including that in either one of them. I think because the contract is a contract, it's a little bit different. We haven't, that's part of the standard contract that we have. it might be something for consideration as we move forward and look at different ways of different compensation models as we've been talking about. So I did want to mention that. Now, this is to be acted on this evening, correct, in the consent agenda?
Correct. And just a clarification, Mrs. Hancock, the 2.07 on the administrative supervisory, you'll see that in this case, the longevity, that value recognition, and also the professional growth, that's what lessens or reduces that 2.07 amount down. But it's not very significant as it happens.
Because it's in the heading of this, then maybe I'm reading that wrong. Continuous growth stipends and 3% value recognition is not included in the 2.024.
Yeah. So this, the numbers, the base salary that you have listed here represents an average of a 2.024% increase. Okay. And so that very minor difference to a 2.07 is what is taken up by that one longevity move and that one new professional growth. So again, not very significant, but just explaining the difference there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So again, it is part of the consent agenda. So then moving on. I need to go back. To ACT results and AP results. Mrs. Savasky.
Two microphones tonight, thank you. So I just want to share with you our ACT and our AP results tonight and just give you an update on how they match our strategic objectives and also our district PDSAs. So right in front of us is our vision statement, educating every student to achieve global success. And I think these results show how we are helping our kids be career and college ready after they leave our schools. So just a review on ACT. ACT is a college admissions assessment for English, social sciences, which that falls under the reading category, science and math. It's a multiple choice test for those four areas. And there is an optional writing component. And colleges use it to benchmark our kids to see if they are truly prepared for college. So this chart shows our data since 2000 to 2001 until last year. And you'll notice the trend line for Holmen has gone up. Even though our scores took a very tiny dip this year, the trend line is going up. When I put the same trend line in for the state, it was just flat. And when you put it in for the nation, it actually goes down. So that's some good information, but when all those lines are on there, the charts are quite messy. This chart shows our participation rate, and unfortunately, I don't know how to make that. I see you have something over the front of your screen. And then I'm afraid if I touch anything, it's going to go off. So it just shows our participation rate over this same period of time. It has gone up compared to last year. It's gone up just under 3%. We are above the state rate, and continue to be over the state rate and as far as participation. The state rate, which you cannot, oh, there, thank you, Jay. The state rate is 61.8% of students participate in the ACT. And it's always good to check and see how we're doing against our neighbors. And this chart shows how we are doing compared to our conference plus the two extra schools that we usually compare ourselves to. And if we start back in 2009, we were within those seven districts, we were ranked fifth and below the state average. In 2010, we were seventh and below the state average. In 2011, we were fourth, and we are just below the state average. In 2012, we were ranked second out of these area schools and above the state average. And in 2013, this year, again, ranked second, tied with West Salem, and above the state average. So celebrations overall, our students' composites scores are near the top of the state average. If you look, we were 1/10 of a point below, so great news. Second year in a row, we are above the state average. Second year in a row, even though we did have that minor dip in our scores, we're still 1.8 points above the national average. The expectation for students in math, English, and the social sciences were above the college readiness benchmark. Something interesting to note, I've reported to you in the past that we struggle with, meeting the college readiness benchmark in the area of science. And when you look nationally, other districts around the nation had that issue too, and they have lowered the college readiness benchmark from 24 to 23 nationally, and now we are at 22.7, so we're just a smidge below the readiness benchmark. So because ACT will be given statewide soon, it's that portion of, continuing to plan to meet Wisconsin No Child Left Behind waiver, because if you remember, ACT will be funded by the state and all 100% of our students will take it, as opposed to where we're at that just below 65% at this time. Continue in our PLCs to review the rigor of our courses and our alignment of our courses to the Common Core state standards, and then use our data from Plan and Explore, because those also will be a statewide assessment and other common assessments, because we know they can provide us invaluable data, to continue to counsel our students. How can they meet the college and readiness benchmarks? How can we adjust instruction to ensure that we are aligned to the Common Core, and then those students that are struggling, giving them timely interventions to help them meet the benchmarks.
Are they going to change, if the ACT is a benchmark for college and university readiness, and we know that not all of our students will go to college or a university, are they looking at making changes to the test so that it is more of a student-wide or accurate reflection of what's being tested?
That's a great question. That is something I know Dr. Carlson and I went to a session with our legislatures and DPI talking about. There are other measures, for example, the COMPASS test for our kids that choose technical colleges. At this time, it didn't sound like the state was interested in pursuing that avenue, but in the future, they talk about our school report cards, that may be a measure in the future of how we're doing, but right now it's going to be ACT. So, but they are, your question about changing it, they will have to change the ACT to match the Common Core when it is given statewide. Mm-hmm. So there will be changes to it, but it would be nice if they used other things to measure also.
And so the, you said it's funded by the state, because there is a cost to take.
Yes.
And do you anticipate that's going to be pushed off to the school districts eventually?
I hope.
I think we see that happen sometimes.
It happens sometimes. I mean, I wish I had a crystal ball to know what's going to happen. I know it's in the biennial budget for the next couple years, and we'll see from there what the state chooses to do.
Thank you.
And this, you've probably seen in the Student Learning Plan Do Study Acts, or the PDSAs, and this just shows how does it match our goals that we've set for the district. Our baseline was an average of 3 years scores, which was 22, and our goal for this year was 22.3, and the green shows our actual composite average score was 22.7, so to just give you an idea how we're aligned to our goals.
And with this, some people may wonder, well, we actually went down 0.2 from a year ago, so why would that goal be a 22.3? We look out to that 5 years to ultimately that 23.4 is our ending goal. So we know along the way we might have ups and downs, and so we are really targeting that end goal. And so, but certainly can understand why some people might ask that question.
And in addition, we also think, you know, right now we're only testing, or only 65% of the students are testing. In 2014-15, that spring, it will be all students. So, you know, we do expect probably a decline. We'd hope that it wouldn't happen, but, you know, when more students do take it, there's a possibility.
Are we doing anything to encourage more students to take it now, or is it financially not possible?
Right now, students choose to take it on their own and pay for it financially, so it's more the students that are looking into a four-year university as a possible option.
Thank you.
So, any other questions about ACT before I move on to AP or advanced placement?
Not a question, but just a comment, just a congratulations. Celebrations. This is something to celebrate, even though it's, you know, it did go down a smidgen, I think is your term, scientific term.
Yes.
But 22.3 is the goal, and we're at 22.7. That's something to be proud of, knowing that there's going to be a lot of work to come. And,
right,
you know, where we ranked compared to the other districts in the area, I think, too, is something that we oftentimes benchmark ourselves against them, and coming in second
is amazing.
Okay, being number one is where we want to be, of course, but...
And when you go back and look at that over time data, I think this is the only time where we've had 2 years in a row above the state average. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty amazing, too.
So congratulations to you and to all of the staff in the district. Absolutely.
Yeah. I just want to echo that. I mean, that is just phenomenal. It is, you know, I always look at stack rank, and if everybody drops, it's how do you compare? And obviously, I think that's really great to see. The other part, since I've been on this board, seems like we've always been chasing a neighbor to our south, and I noticed those scores as well, so congratulations.
So send those to our high school, Mr. Bear.
Thank you, Bob. I know you're doing a lot of prep work and things in the high school, and so it is paying off, and that's good to see.
I think it helps that we do explore, plan, and Patty Shepard heads up the ACT.
We'll give her our congratulations too.
I will.
Thank you.
So then advanced placement courses help kids achieve the skills and habits that they will need to be successful in college, as far as problem solving, a lot more writing, some time management skills because of the requirements of the course, discipline to stick with it, and even study habits. Another benefit of taking an advanced placement course is once the students achieve a 3 or greater on the exam, they are able to earn college credit for when they are in a 4-year university. Oops. I think one of my slides might have switched. But this is just our history over time that shows how many students are in the courses, and you will notice in the first column that number continues to increase. The second column is how many students or how many exams are actually taken by those students, and then the number of different exam areas that the students are taking. And then this slide goes into detail and it compares the prior year to just give you a little sense of where we're at. The first column shows how many students are enrolled in the course. The second column is how many students or what percentage of students received a 3 or greater in 2011-12, and then compared to 2012-13. And you know, we see a few ups and downs, but a lot of ups. And really, I think, and I've spoken to some college admissions people, if you're having 75% of your students get a 3 or greater, that's a good measure. So you'll notice later in my report that I do use that 75%. So this is the percentage of students receiving, taking that whole last chart and putting it all in one. Where are we at? And we're at 75.2% of our students are receiving that 3 or greater score, so they're eligible for college credit. And we are above the state and the nation average, or the national average. And this is also an interesting slide that you can see that the percentage of our high school students taking advanced placement courses continue to rise, which is a great thing when we say we want all our kids to be career and college ready. So again, celebration, the number of courses offered within our high school so that we're offering our students chances beyond high school. The percentage and the number of students, again, have gone up. 6 out of the 11 courses met that benchmark of 75% of the students or greater getting a 3 on their or higher on their courses. Goals is to continue to review and evaluate the alignment and rigor of the courses, continue to increase the percentage of students taking these courses, and ensure that educators have the training to offer the courses. And I know this last summer, a number of the high school educators went through AP training, and I believe that's in the plan again for this coming summer. So, again, end with our vision, educating every student to achieve global success. And I think this report's a lot of great things to celebrate.
Any questions or comments on this, the AP?
Just a comment, and just make sure I understand it, because I think it has the effect of maybe understating a little bit. On the percentage of Holmen High School students taking exams at 17.5%, if we would assume, and I'm doing some mathematical calculations here, if we would assume 60% are taking the ACT, so 17% taking that, so roughly it's almost a third of those that are taking the ACT or saying that I'm going to be college bound are taking AP courses. So that 17.5 looks somewhat low, but it's actually probably almost a third of those
Definitely.
That are saying that I'm planning to go on to college are actually taking AP if I put
right.
those two stats together.
Yep, and then they're leaving high school with the ability to have those credits yep. once they get to college, so that's great news.
And as a parent of college students, these were very valuable, and for anybody who's out there listening, it does help save money.
Yes.
So, which is always very important.
Yes.
And I would think, too, from a, more of an anecdotal observation, is that while the cost, there's a financial benefit, but what we hear continually is the students that go on and experiencing more success and glad that they took the AP curriculum to help prepare them for that rigor. And we're personally, we're just hopefully going to benefit from that as well as our oldest this year freshman at college. So, but that's what we have heard over the years too, from students who have gone on, and just the benefit of that rigor.
Yeah, and that support while they're still in high school and they're at home a little more compared to their freshman year in college.
So, do you just get these results now from the testing? So
yes, those they don't come out until end of July, beginning of August. So
what kind of support do you provide then to those staff of those classes that were offered that didn't attain that 75%? Is there any kind of interventions we do with the faculty so that they are able to?
So, and that's why some of the teachers did go to AP training this summer.
Did they know this summer?
They knew from last year's results that there was a gap.
Okay.
Or they're new to the area.
In these classes, how many students are in the advanced placement courses?
It varies by course, and I know the AP psychs were very full. I don't know if you want to add more.
Your class average will range anywhere from a low of 15 or so all the way up to 32. Just of all AP psychs are probably an average of 30.
Yeah, I had 56 in psych last year, so. Mm-hmm. So these don't represent one section. If it's 19, that may be two sections of that. But
possibly.
the one that was nine, that would only be one section.
One section, yeah.
Because I know that those numbers.
But not all necessarily test. So, for example, I think the AP stats, as I recall, again, there was nine or so, but more in the class. It's not required that the students take the exam. Yeah. And then also that there, you notice that one column might have said number of exams off to the far right, and there's one less. It went from like 12 to 11, something like, if you have that. And again, that's just, I think, was the comparative politics, as I recall. And that's not in itself a course that we offer, that you take that exam. But it is available for students to take the exam. So I don't want you to think that we have reduced our curriculum by a course necessarily. So, and there's a couple, I think the lit, the first two, English language and composition, English literature and again, that doesn't necessarily represent two different courses.
They might be combined.
Yeah, I know. I think, Mr. Bear, I think a lot of the AP Lit students, for example, will take, most of them may take both of those, for example.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You don't even have to be in any AP class to take any AP exam.
Right. Thank you.
What about other, I know that, so the students, when they do well, then they get those credits. Do we have other programs that we have concurrent enrollment where our faculty member may have an agreement with the technical school or even with some of the colleges to provide student credits upon completion?
A lot of our career and technical ed courses have transcripted credits. So,
and is that what they call it in Wisconsin, concurrent enrollment? It would be interesting, I think, to see a report on that. I don't know if I'm the only one that would be interested, but it would be interesting to see. I don't know if we've received that.
They don't necessarily, the way it's different with the transcripted credit, you don't have to pass an exam. So I know
you just have to pass the class.
You just have to pass the class and share the transcripts with the technical college. So.
Okay, yeah, it would be of interest, I think, just to know what courses are being offered that
Definitely.
Way, because I know a lot of, with the higher cost of secondary education, students, if they can take either that on our site or they take the other classes right at the sources, it can eliminate some of those costs for them.
Definitely. So. Okay. I will look into that for you.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, then. The police liaison contract, Dr. Carlson.
In your packet, you have an issue paper as well as copies of a position description and the contract that the Village of Holmen provides to us. And so at the next board meeting, the board will be asked to consider approval. Again, this is something that, while it may seem routine because we have had this partnership now for a few years, I do want you to know that, especially the position description, there's been a lot of work back and forth trying to revise this, and so I've had a couple meetings with representatives of the village, the administrator is also the chief of police, and so I appreciate their willingness to work through this. And so I think we have a good position description and in place, and they seem to be very pleased with it. And so unless you have questions, we'll bring this back to the next board meeting for approval.
Any questions? Tim?
No, it's 50%, and that has been consistent with the past, is that correct?
Correct.
And I'm trying to do the quick math here on the increase, and I was sorry I didn't do that ahead because I'd seen the increase. It appears that there's a, just trying to look at the math here, but about a $4,000 increase.
Well, yeah, for our cost, is what you're talking about, yeah. Yeah, maybe a little bit more, but in that ballpark, correct.
So that would almost be a 17% increase, roughly. I'm just trying to do some pencil math here. Does that seem normal for a 17% increase in that?
And I apologize, I don't have the trend of the last so many years and the...
Yeah, and I'm just going on the issue paper that the cost was 23,616.
Right.
And this year approximately 28,500. And obviously the need for it, and I support it, but it seems like that's a pretty
Is COLA used in this negotiation in any way?
Is what?
Cost of living adjustment.
I don't have the specifics to that right now, tonight.
Is there a difference between the base wage increase plus the benefits increase? Is that lumping that all together?
And that could
wages
explain.
And benefits, because I know the benefits definitely cost has increased for benefits.
And I just don't, I want to stop short of speculating, but I just don't have that specific data. I can certainly get that and forward it on as to the reason for the increase. And I certainly can do that.
And I'm not opposed to it even at this. It just seemed like a larger percentage increase. That's why I just wanted to make sure that rate splitting of 50% had not changed.
That has not changed, okay. Correct. Thank you.
Any other questions? I would just, and maybe I was missing it, but the issue with the liaison officer, I know he or she is not able to respond to the Academy on the Prairie in a legal issue, but will they be able to make some of those positive student contacts?
Yes, and that has been part of our conversation, great conversation. There's a willingness among everyone on that, and they feel it's important, and actually our officer can respond to issues, but may need to involve assistance. Mm-hmm. But so, absolutely, and I know that that's a conversation we've had, and again, total support of servicing our students wherever they may be. And I know that Mr. Bear, that Officer Hickey's even down at prom in La Crosse and working with our students. And so absolutely, but thank you for the question. Yep.
Good, yeah, I know that's come up and just wanted to make sure that had been addressed. Thank you for making sure it was. So then the next thing is the community center update, I guess I just, for purposes, we did have a closed session earlier this evening related to the community center. We are talking as a board with the community collaboration center group, and I can't remember the other tagline they had, but we are talking about some issues related to the leasing or purchase or of the property and the building, and developing a lease agreement, which will then come to the public We've identified a strategy, and I know Tim, myself, and Jay will be working firsthand with the committee to bring that then to the board, and we'll keep the board informed on the progress. There was a question that was asked about the community use of this portion of the building, and I would assure you that the committee has been very diligently working on ensuring that entities from throughout the community will have the opportunity to utilize the building, whether it's the school district during the day for some of their coursework and overflow type things, to senior meal opportunities, to youth centers after school, to weekend events in the community. They are looking at establishing a 501c3, which will have representation from all municipalities, with the assurance that we equally play a role in developing the programming, and we also play a role in the responsibilities for the financial support of the building itself. So if you have any specific issues, please let myself, Jay, Tim, anyone know. Make questions, because if we get those questions up front, that will help us develop a all-inclusive sort of agreement. But I just wanted to report out on that. So we are making progress, and it's a very positive thing. I know that committee is ready to get out there and do some fundraising, so that's a great thing to see in the community. And all of the Town of Holland was here, represented. Town of Onalaska was represented this evening. Lori was here as the key leader, and Dan McHugh again as one of the key leaders of the group. So then, moving on to board member reports and discussion, I'll call on the board members in the order of roll call to ask them to present any comments or committee reports. Lisa Collins.
I did want to mention an event coming up that this is the fifth annual year the La Crosse Area Suicide Prevention Initiative gives a suicide prevention summit, and it's in the form of the evening before the summit, which is similar to like a training or a conference. They have a walk down by Riverside Park as kind of a remembrance kind of thing, and they have speakers that come and talk about suicide and how it's impacted their lives. This is coming up. September 18th is the actual conference and the summit, and it's being held at the University of Wisconsin La Crosse, actually the extension is the one that's actually putting it on, but it's going to be at the La Crosse Center. And they really are encouraging everyone from the community to, you know, be willing to participate or come and listen to the different breakout sessions. they'll be having panels talking about people that, you know, have had mental health issues in their families and how suicide has affected their lives, from combining of drugs and alcohol and the effects of that on suicide, accidental suicide and things like that. I know it's not a very happy topic, but it definitely is something worth getting together and discussing. They have a committee that gets together one time monthly to plan, and that committee is comprised of mental health professionals, doctors, teachers, school administrators, and how we can all kind of come together to work on how to make this less of a problem in our community, our state. So September 18th, and it's 8:30 to 5 at the La Crosse Center, and you can call the Continuing Education Extension Department of the University of La Crosse.
Thank you. Mr. Dunlap.
It was nice to have another meeting. We got lots of good news and lots of sunshine. You have the financial and independent auditors report. I recommend you hang on to that. It's a great reference. It has all our goals in it, and it has our where we've been and where we are and where we're going. So hang on to it over the year, and use it for reference. Congratulations on the ACT and the AP scores. Now that's always great news. We have finance committee meeting the third Monday of this month at 4:00. Everyone's welcome to come. It's always exciting, of course. And also, I'd just like to mention the letter that we got from the New Prague athletic director. Our football team went up there and played their team, And he sent a letter down saying in 10 years, he'd never sent a letter out congratulating a football team for how well behaved they were and how well behaved the crowd was. And he never heard thank you so many times in his whole career. It's a great feather in the cap of Holmen School District, and I was so proud to hear someone send a letter like that and say that about our boys. And of course, we all knew that at the start. They're all good kids, and it just proves that we're doing the right thing, not only with the classroom, but doing the right things, bringing them up as adults. So I'm very proud of them.
Thank you, Mr. Dunlap. Mm-hmm. Mr. Gittens?
No comments.
Okay, Mrs. Jagosinski?
I would echo what Mr. Dunlap had said. I was going to make a comment about that letter that was written to the athletic director also, and about the crowds and the, the participants in the school district I work in. We have the parents sign a, it's called a parent code of conduct, actually, for parents whose kids are participating in athletics. And it's sad that that's necessary. And it was kind of nice to have this email sent out as kind of the opposite side of the spectrum, that you not only have parents that aren't yelling at referees and screaming, at least not that this athletic director saw that night, I think. No. But that just a good sportsmanship. I remember we used to get good sportsmanship notes Lindsay used to share with us every once in a while. We would get good pats on the back, so that was pretty nice to see. And just as an aside, I noticed that there aren't too many teachers in the audience tonight, and I'm guessing that's because it's the first couple weeks of school and they're all totally exhausted. And I work in a school too, so let's wrap this up, because so that's all I have.
Okay, Mrs. Mayer?
No, I don't have anything tonight.
Okay, Mr. Mettinger?
I always have comments, but just a couple tonight. I want to just echo everybody else has said here. Great meeting, lots of good positive things going on in the school district, and lots to be proud of. I do want to just in kind of piggyback on Anita's, really just thank everyone, all the support staff, teachers, everybody who's got this school year off to a great start. And I know it's been exceptionally hard because for the students it's still feeling like summer. And so really hard to keep them focused and engaged. So thank you to everybody that has had a part in getting the school year off to a great start. And just encourage everybody to get out. Lots of great things going on in the schools, on the fields, in the gyms. So get out and cheer on Holmen.
Thank you. Colin Trivett.
I think going along with what Tim said, as a student last week, it was great to get back into school, see everyone again. And then teachers made it fantastic getting back, getting readjusted, and seeing how everything works, especially for the freshmen being the first time at the high school, and then the sixth graders going into middle school. Just good to see the staff and the teachers helping them out as they progress along through grades. And then also, I just wanted to touch on the AP classes a bit. Being a student that takes AP classes a lot, it is, I just feel it's so important that we keep offering them, and that it is encouraged that people, that students take them. It is being able to get college credits in high school, it just feels like it's so important and such an asset to students that are going to be going on to college. So just wanted to thank the school board and the district for their encouragement and progression for the AP courses being offered.
Okay, thank you very much. It's always good to hear from a student perspective. I just have also, again, kudos to everyone for getting the school year off in a good and positive manner. I think in my statement I said it's so nice for our students to have that smiling face in the office, a supportive person in the classroom, a well-trained teacher in the classroom helping our students, schools that students are proud to walk into, good meals that they want to participate in and that allow them to be ready to learn then, and safe transportation each and every day to school. And it's been fun for me to see that happen firsthand, and it just brings home what we're here for. And then we talk about the AP courses and that kind of thing, and it really solidifies that we are making some progress in some areas, and that the global side of things with the talk about Syria and everything, hoping that we put into perspective that we're here to train leaders that hopefully in the future won't get us to the place where we are in the world, and always wanting to reflect on that, and hopefully one or two of our students will be in that world leadership role sometime in the future. I know that we do have a personnel and governance meeting this Wednesday on September 11th that we'll also try to keep short. And I would just note that the correspondence folder, I think, is going around, if there is one. I haven't seen it yet. We do have a September 23rd regular board meeting, new staff reception, and I did get to meet the new staff, and they are a great-looking group, and didn't get to talk with them, but I know that some of the ones I did talk with were very, as I said, they made it through a very robust screening process, so they should be congratulated for being there. So if you could get here around 6:30 to meet them, that would be great at the next meeting. October 8th is the WASB regional meeting in Toma, and I know we have about 4 people going right now. We would have room, and we can carpool. I don't know, Dr. Carlson, if you're planning to go, we can figure out how to carpool. Some may attend the meeting early. There's a training early. If I'm available, I would like to go to that, but working on schedules and those sorts of things. Then October 14th and the 28th, regular board meetings. We have the November 5th workshop at 5:30, a follow-up from the recent one that you had, and then November 11th is the regular board meeting. Again, Veterans Day, correct? November 11th, I think. Board policies and administrative rules for review and input.
If I could just bring attention to B, that is to be deleted. So 174, board organizational meeting. So delete that for now. And just asking for your review on the other two, 131.2 and 773, before it's passed on to the personnel and governance.
So if there were any changes to our oath of office that you feel we should be making, or any changes to the data management, now is the time to share those with the full board. Otherwise, the Personnel and Governance Committee, we will study those very deeply. Okay, then consent agenda items. We have the personnel report, financial claims and accounts, executive assistant base wage agreement, and administrator and supervisor base wage agreements. Is there any of those items that a board member would like to have pulled for separate consideration? If not, I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda items as presented. Is there a second?
A second.
Discussion on any of those? Seeing none, all of those in favor of approving the consent agenda items, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. And the next item is adjournment.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of adjourning, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. We are adjourned. Is that clicking for you? Is there Monday night football?
No. Yes.
Is there?